Good evening, students. All of you, welcome to the class. So yesterday we are discussing electrode potentials and chemical reactivity. In the 3D series, from scandium to zinc, excluding the zinc, except of zinc, from scandium to copper, as the atomic size decreases, ionization energy increases. As the ionization energy increases, the SRP values of M2 plus single electrode M values also increases. And coming to the copper, copper is the 3D series element that is going to have positive SRP value. So because of this positive SRP value, means copper is the electrode having highest SRP value. That is the value plus 0.34 volts. So because of this positive SRP value, copper cannot displace hydrogen gas from acids. And in the 3D series elements, the three elements, manganese, nickel, zinc, they are going to have more negative SRP values than the expected. Why? Because means manganese is having 3D5 configuration. Nickel is having high hydration energy, whereas zinc is having 3D10 configuration. As a result, these three elements are having exceptionally more negative SRP values. And in Mn3 plus, CO3 plus, both are acting as strong reducing agents. Among these two, which one is strong reducing agent means they're acting as strong oxidizing agents, not reducing. They're acting as strong oxidizing agents. Among these two, Mn3 plus and CO3 plus, Mn3 plus is acting as a more oxidizing agent because Mn3 plus is having D4 configuration that is ready to gain one electron to convert into Mn2 plus. So anyway, coming to the SRP values of Mn3 plus and CO3 plus, if you observe these values, these two ions are having high SRP values of M3 plus single electrode, M2 plus. Note on this point, if any electrode having high SRP values of M3 plus single electrode, M2 plus, such electrodes are such metal ions are acting as strong oxidizing agents. Strong oxidizing agents. Write down the note. This note is important for both NEET and JEE. The first point, the element with high negative SRP value act as strong reducing agent. We are studying about 3D series, right? In the next line, next point. In 3D series elements, zinc is having high negative SRP value. That is minus 0.76 volts. Hence, in 3D series, zinc is acting as a strong reducing agent. Next point. While copper is having positive SRP value, that is plus 0.34 volts, plus 0.34 volts. Hence, in 3D series, copper is acting as strong oxidizing agent. So from this note, we can understand that any electrode with high negative SRP value act as strong reducing agent. Electrode with high positive SRP values that is acting as strong oxidizing agent. If you come to Fe3 plus single electrode Fe2 plus, Fe3 plus is having D5 configuration, more stable configuration. Fe2 plus is having B6 configuration, less stable configuration. So Fe3 plus is not ready to donate the electron because it is having D5 configuration. If it is going to donate the electron, it becomes as D4. If it is going to gain the electron, it becomes as D6. So Fe3 plus is not ready to gain the electron or lose the electron. But if you observe the Fe2 plus, here Fe2 plus is ready to lose the electron. Then which conversion is easy? The conversion of Fe2 plus to Fe3 plus is easy. But the conversion of Fe3 plus to Fe2 plus is not easy. See this one? E0 of Fe3 plus single electrode Fe2 plus is low because Fe3 plus is having stable electronic configuration. And E0 of Mn3 plus single electrode Mn2 plus is high. Here, E0 of Fe3 plus single electrode Fe2 plus is low, whereas E0 of Mn3 plus single electrode Mn2 plus is high. Why? Because means Mn3 plus is having a configuration of D4, Mn2 plus is having a configuration of D5. So D4 configuration is ready to convert into D5 configuration by gaining electron. So which conversion is easy? The conversion of D4 to D5 is easy by gaining an electron by the D4. That means the conversion of Mn3 plus to Mn2 plus is easy. So here we can say that E0 of Mn3 plus single electrode Mn2 plus is going to have high standard reduction potential because Mn2 plus is going to have D5 configuration. So please try to understand the relation between E0 of Fe3 plus single electrode Fe2 plus and E0 of Mn3 plus single electrode Mn2 plus. Here Fe3 plus is having D5 configuration. Hence, it is not easy to convert Fe3 plus to Fe2 plus. That's why E0 of Fe3 plus single electrode Fe2 plus is having low SRP value. Whereas the conversion of Mn3 plus to Mn2 plus is very easy. That's why E0 of Mn3 plus single electrode Mn2 plus is having high SRP value. So coming to this oxidizing agent and reducing agent. Among all these, which conversion is easy? Conversion of Fe2 plus to Fe3 plus is easy. Like that, the conversion of Mn3 plus to Mn2 plus is easy. The conversion of Fe2 plus to Fe3 plus is indicating Fe3 plus is acting as oxidizing agent. Whereas the conversion of Mn3 plus to Mn2 plus is indicating Mn3 plus is acting as oxidizing agent. So both Fe3 plus and Mn3 plus, they're acting as oxidizing agents, right? And if you consider remaining elements, titanium, vanadium, chromium, these are acting as strong reducing agents. So because of this strong reducing nature, they can displace hydrogen gas from the dilute acids. For example, you know, zinc. If zinc is going to react, here I'm writing the reaction. If the zinc is going to react with dilute HCl, what you can say the reaction? Zn plus 2 moles of HCl gives rise to ZnCl2 plus H2. So what is going to be displaced from the acid? Hydrogen gas is going to be displaced from the acid. This is acid. From this acid, hydrogen gas is going to be displaced. The hydrogen gas is displaced by zinc because zinc is having negative SRP value. So if any electrode having negative SRP value, that electrode is acting as reducing agent. So the electrodes which are acting as reducing agents, they can displace hydrogen gas from acids. Like that, here in this case, zinc is converting into Zn2+. So like that, here if you observe, titanium 2+, vanadium 2+, chromium 2+, all these are also acting as reducing agents. So that's why they can displace hydrogen gas from dilute acids. Please note down these examples: Ti2+, V2+, Cr2+. They are acting as reducing agents. Hence, they can displace or they can liberate hydrogen gas from dilute acids. So, which type of reagents can displace hydrogen gas from dilute acids? Which type of reagents can displace hydrogen gas from dilute acids? Which type of reagents can displace hydrogen gas from dilute acids? Strong reducing agents can displace hydrogen gas from dilute acids. Okay, coming to the Cr2+. Here Cr2+ is acting as a reducing agent. If you take the Fe2+, Fe2+ is having which configuration? D6 configuration.
D6.
So, yes, tell me.
D6.
Yes, D6 configuration. So we are comparing the Cr2+ and Fe2+. So in Fe2+, it is going to change from where to where. When it is going to act as a reducing agent, from where to where the configuration is going to change. Fe2+ and Cr2+. I'm going to write on the screen. Yes, here I'm taking iron as well as chromium. Iron, what is the symbol of iron? Fe. The symbol of iron is Fe. Atomic number is 26. Electronic configuration. Argon, 4s2, 3d6. If I write Fe2+, the electronic configuration is argon, 4s0, 3d6. Whereas chromium, atomic number 24, electronic configuration, argon, 4s1, 3d5. But when chromium plus 2 is taken, or chromium 2 plus is taken, the electronic configuration is argon, 4s0, 3d4. Here 3d4 is there. Whereas in Fe2+, 3d6 is there. Now, which one is ready to gain the electron?
Cr+2.
Electron gaining species act as oxidizing agent or reducing agent?
Oxidizing agent.
So electron gaining species. Electron gaining species act as oxidizing agent. Electron gaining species act as oxidizing agent. So that's why among Fe2+ and Cr2+, Cr2+ is going to gain one electron. Then Cr2+ is converting into Cr3+. Now Cr3+ is having a configuration of 3d5. Whereas Fe2+ is ready to lose the electron, minus electron. I'm writing minus here, minus electron. Then Fe2+ is converting into Fe3+. Fe3+ is having 3d5 configuration. So electron losing tendency, electron donating tendency is called as reducing nature. Electron losing tendency or electron donating tendency is called as reducing nature or reducing power. So Fe2+ ions are having reducing power, whereas Cr2+ ions are having oxidizing power. So Cr2+ ions are acting as oxidizing agents. Fe2+ ions are acting as reducing agents. So if any ion is given, not only iron or not only chromium, among the 3D series elements, if any ion is given in any oxidation state, whether it is plus 1, plus 2, plus 3, plus 4, plus 5, plus 6, whatever the oxidation state is given, you have to check whether that given ion is ready to lose the electron or gain the electron. If any given ion is ready to lose the electron, then that ion is going to possess reducing power. If any ion given is ready to gain the electron, then that is having oxidizing power. So this is the concept only. If you understand the concept, you can find whether it is oxidizing agent or reducing agent. So if it is the oxidizing agent, that undergoes reduction. Okay, tell me, oxidizing agents can have high SRP values or low SRP values?
Low SRP.
Oxidizing agents are having high SRP or low SRP? Zinc is having low SRP, ma. Zinc is having low SRP, copper is having high SRP. Zinc is acting as reducing agent, copper is acting as oxidizing agent. In galvanic cell, once again, I'm saying in galvanic cell, zinc is having minus 0.76 volts. Zinc is acting as reducing agent. So if any electrode having less SRP value act as reducing agent, an electrode having high SRP value act as oxidizing agent. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Is there any doubt?
No, sir.
Okay, fine. Now tell me, reducing power. I am saying reducing power. Iron 2 plus is having reducing power. Whether it is having low SRP or high SRP?
Low SRP, sir.
Reducing power, yes. Reducing power is indicating Fe2 plus ion is having low SRP than compared to Cr2 plus. So here Cr2 plus is having high SRP value. Like that, you have to compare, because they will give different ions. They will ask for the order of reducing power, order of oxidizing power, or order of SRP values also. If you can understand the number of electrons present, whether they are ready to lose the electrons or gain the electrons, then you can understand whether they are having reducing power or oxidizing power. Then you can say whether they are having low SRPs or high SRPs. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine.
Sir,
coming to tell me.
Cr plus 2 plus electron, Cr plus 1.
Cr?
Plus 1.
By gaining one electron. Thank you. So Cr3 plus, not the 3 plus. You have to write by gaining one electron, right? Oxidation state get decreases. Sorry. So we have to write what we have to write here. Cr plus 1. Okay. Right. Thank you. So coming to our page. Yes, on the screen you are seeing now. So Cr2 plus is reducing agent than Fe2 plus. So take the screenshot of this page. You can read, you can understand. So it is all about SRP values and chemical reactivity. And on the right side of the screen, you are seeing two complex ions. Please write down the complex ions in your notes. I'm going to explain something about these two complex ions. CrH2O taken 6 times 2 plus. CrH2O taken 6 times 2 plus. And FeH2O taken 6 times 2 plus. What is the similarity in these two?
Cationic complex.
Very good. Second thing is octahedral complexes. Octahedral complexes. Coordination number is 6. And third one is both are having same type of ligands, H2O. Then my question to you is, which complex is more stable? Which complex is more stable? Okay.
H2O taken.
So you are saying that it is going to be more stable. How can we explain? First of all, we have to take chromium oxidation state. That is, chromium is present in plus 2 oxidation state. When it is in plus 2 oxidation state, the electronic configuration of Cr2 plus is 3d4. 3d4 is unstable. 3d4 is unstable. It is ready to gain the electron as well as it is ready to lose the electron. Remember, it is ready to gain the electron, it is ready to lose the electron. If it is ready to lose the electron, if it is ready to lose the electron, what we will get? 3d3 configuration. 3d3 configuration means T2g3 is 0. It is a stable configuration. T2g3 means half filled configuration. So chromium 2 plus is having 3d4 configuration. We are going to expect it is going to gain the electron. But in water, because water is acting as a weak ligand, in weak ligands, the chromium 2 plus 3d4 configuration is going to lose the electron to get T2g3 is 0 configuration. Now, when any species is ready to lose the electron, ready to donate the electron, if any species ready to lose the electron or ready to donate the electron, that species act as reducing agent. So here Cr2 plus is ready to lose the electron, that is acting as reducing agent. Then in Cr2 plus, how many unpaired electrons are present? Four unpaired electrons are present. In Cr2 plus, four unpaired electrons are present. In Cr3 plus, how many unpaired electrons are present?
Three
unpaired electrons, because it is having the configuration of T2G0, T2G3 is 0. Now check this complex, iron complex. In this iron complex, here, iron is present in plus 2 oxidation state. The electronic configuration is 3D6. Yes, now 3D6, very clearly we can say, sir, 3D6 is ready to lose the electron. No confusion. No confusion. But in the case of chromium 2 plus, there is a confusion. Because chromium 2 plus is having 3D4 configuration. It is ready to gain the electron in general, but in aqueous medium. Because water is acting as a weak ligand, it is ready to lose the electron. That's why we are going to get 3D3 configuration. Electron donating space is said to be as strong reducing agent. But in the case of iron complex, Fe2 plus is converting into Fe3 plus. Electron donating space is called as reducing agent. Again, reducing agent. So in both the complexes, chromium 2 plus and Fe2 plus, both are acting as reducing agents. My question is, in Fe2 plus, 3D6 configuration is there. How many unpaired electrons are there? Four unpaired electrons are there. Whereas Fe3 plus, it is having 5 unpaired electrons. Now, tell me, when in these two complexes, which is going to be more stable, how we can explain? Both chromium 2 plus is having 4 unpaired electrons, and Fe2 plus is also having 4 unpaired electrons. When unpaired electrons are same, the magnetic moment is same, right? The structure is same. Everything is same. Which one is going to be more stable? Which one is going to be more stable? Yes, this is the reason. Here the reason is given. In aqueous solutions, 3D3 configuration is more stable than 3D5 configuration. Very simple. 3D3 configuration is more stable than 3D5 configuration. Yes, I'm going to erase everything. Just a minute. Once again, see this, ma. When chromium 2 plus is converting into chromium 3 plus, 3D4 configuration is converting into 3D3 configuration. So here 3D3 configuration is having how many unpaired electrons? Only 3 unpaired electrons. Whereas Fe2 plus is converting into Fe3 plus, how many unpaired electrons are there in Fe3 plus? 5 unpaired electrons are there. Where the magnetic moment is more? Where the magnetic moment is more? In case of Fe3 plus, because n value is equal to 5 here. N value is equal to 5 here. Here, N value is equal to 3 only. Which one is more paramagnetic? Fe3 plus is more paramagnetic. Cr3 plus is less paramagnetic. If it is less paramagnetic, that becomes more stable. If there is no magnetic nature, that does not attracted by anything, that does not involve in the reaction. Very simple. So as the number of unpaired electrons decreases, the reactivity in aqueous solutions get decreases. So based on this, we can understand that in aqueous solutions, 3D3 configuration is more stable than 3D5 configuration. Write down this point, note. In aqueous solutions, configuration is more stable than 3D5 configuration. 3D3 configuration is more stable than 3D5 configuration. So that's why we can say that CrH2O taken 6 times 2 plus is more stable than FeH2O taken 6 times 2 plus. So among the Cr2 plus and Fe2 plus, Cr2 plus is a strong reducing agent than Fe2 plus. Cr2 plus is a strong reducing agent than Fe2 plus. So some of the ions are given. Please write down this order. Order of oxidizing power of the electrodes. order of oxidizing power of the electrodes. CO3 plus single electrode CO2 plus is greater than CO3 plus single electrode CO2 plus is greater than Mn3 plus single electrode Mn2 plus is greater than Fe3 plus single electrode Fe2 plus is greater than Pi3 plus single electrode Pi2 plus is greater than SC3 plus single electrode SC2 plus is greater than V3 plus single electrode V2 plus. See here it is given as order of oxidizing power of the electrodes. Order of oxidizing power of the electrodes. For your understanding, here I am writing one example. Cobalt. Cobalt atomic number is 27. Electronic configuration is argon 4s2 3d7. But when cobalt is taken in +3 oxidation state, the electronic configuration is 3d6. And the cobalt is taken in +2 oxidation state, the electronic configuration is 3d7. Now, which conversion is easy? Which conversion is easy? Removal of 2 electrons easy than removal of 3 electrons. All of you know, right? According to ionization energy concept, or according to ionization potential concept, removal of 1 electron is easy than removal of 2 electrons. Removal of 2 electrons is easy than removal of 3 electrons. Then what we can write about ionization energies are there? IE1 is lesser than, in general, not in all cases, in general, IE1 is lesser than, IE2 is lesser than, IE3 and so on. First ionization energy is less than, second ionization energy is less than, third ionization energy. So here, the amount of energy required to remove 2 electrons is IE2. Here, the amount of energy required to remove 3 electrons is IE3. Among these two, which one is more? IE3 is more than IE2. IE3 is more than IE2. So that's why as the ionization energy increases, can you tell me the SRP value? As the ionization energy increases. Very good. Write down that point once again. As the ionization energy increases, very important point, Mark. As the ionization energy increases, the SRP values also increases. Standard reduction potentials. The SRP values also increases. Continuation. As the SRP values increases, oxidizing power also increases. Oxidizing power also increases. So which one is having a high ionization energy? CO3 plus is having IE3 value highest with compared to IE3 of Mn3 plus, with compared to IE3 of Fe3 plus. You can check, you can understand. With compared to IE3 of Pi3 plus, here IE3 of SC3 plus, here it is IE3 of V3 plus. So there is a relation between ionization energies and oxidizing power. As the ionization energies increases, write down this point, straight point. As the ionization energies increases, the oxidizing power also increases. Don't try to byhead the orders. Try to byhead the concept. Try to understand the concept first. So here order is given. What is order given? CO3 plus single electrode CO2 plus is having strong oxidizing power than Mn3 plus single electrode Mn2 plus, than Fe3 plus single electrode Fe2 plus, than Pi3 plus single electrode Pa2 plus, than SC3 plus single electrode SC2 plus, than V3 plus single electrode V2 plus. So among all these ions, CO3 plus, Mn3 plus, Fe3 plus, Ti3 plus, SC3 plus, V3 plus, which ion can be formed easily? Which?
V plus.
Very good, correct. Among these tri-positive ions, these are called as tri-positive ions. Tri-positive ions. If the tri-positive ion can be formed easily, that is having less oxidizing power. That electrode is having less oxidizing power. So the oxidizing power is depending upon the ionization energy. As the ionization energy increases, SRP values increases. As a result, oxidizing power of the element or the electrodes also increases. Next, take the screenshot of this one. Later you can practice. Why is E naught value of Mn3 plus single electrode, Mn2 plus couple is more positive? If they are saying SRP value is more positive, what you can say? What is your answer? Not by seeing the on-screen answer, by thinking yourself. If any electrode is having more positive SRP value, why it should be? If any electrode
less
having
tendency to donate electron.
Less tendency to donate the electron. Correct answer. And simply you can say that, sir, ionization energy is very high. Ionization energy is very high. So if it is having less tendency to donate the electron, means ionization energy is very high. If we can remove the electron easily, ionization energy is low. So we can say that less, yes, correct answer, less tendency to donate the electron. Less tendency. So this couple is having less tendency to donate the electron. Which one is having less tendency to donate the electron? Okay, I'm going to write here manganese atomic number 25, electronic configuration argon 4s2 3d5. When manganese is taken in +2 oxidation state, then the configuration is argon
3d5
4s0 3d5. When manganese is taken in +3 oxidation state, then the electronic configuration is 4s0 3d4. So manganese 3+ is ready to get reduced. Manganese 3+ is ready to get reduced to manganese 2+ by gaining an electron. Because manganese 3+ is having configuration of 3d4, it is ready to gain the electron. By gaining electron, it is converting into Mn2+. So the conversion of Mn3+2, Mn2+ is very easy. If any ion can be converted from higher oxidation state to lower oxidation state, if we are going to write it as an electrode, such electrodes are having this type of values, higher SRP values. Is it understood?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Next one, next topic about magnetic properties of transition metals. Of course, in the complex compounds, we discussed everything. What is the reason for the magnetic properties of transition metals?
Unpaired electrons.
Of course, you have to say DD transition. Of course, correct. Unpaired electrons is correct. But we have to indicate because of the presence of unpaired electrons in these subshells. That is important. Whether it may be N-1 D subshell or it may be ND subshell. Means it may be either inner D orbitals or it may be either in outer D orbitals. So because of the presence of unpaired electrons in D subshell, due to DD transition, the transition metals and their complex ions, they are going to exhibit colors. Of course, okay, that is about colors. of course here we are discussing about magnetic property. Magnetic properties are classified into five types according to solid state. According to the chapter solid state, the magnetic properties are classified into five types: diamagnetic, paramagnetic, ferromagnetic, ferrimagnetic, antiferromagnetic. But in this chapter, we are discussing only three types of magnetism. One is diamagnetic, second one is paramagnetic, and the third one is ferromagnetic. Of course, ferromagnetic is a special category of paramagnetism. Ferromagnetic is a special category of paramagnetism. Diamagnetic means if the pair of electrons are there, means if there is no unpaired electrons are there, then such substances or the ions or the complexes are said to be paramagnetic. If any complex ion or transition metal ion having unpaired electrons, less number of unpaired electrons, then that ion or the complex is said to be paramagnetic. If any complex ion or transition metal ion having more number of unpaired electrons, and all the unpaired electrons must be oriented in the same direction, the spin quantum number should be same. S is equal to plus of plus of plus of plus of, or S is equal to minus of minus of minus of minus of. So to become ferromagnetic, if more number of unpaired electrons, that means more paramagnetic nature is called as ferromagnetic nature. So in terms of physics, all of you know applied magnetism, applied magnetic field, as well as induced magnetic field. Do you heard about these two words? Induced magnetic field and applied magnetic field.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so I'm going to use a little bit physics here to explain this concept. We need a physics a little bit. So applied magnetic field. Suppose I'm taking some substance here. This is some substance. This substance is having some magnetism. That is called as induced magnetic field. The induced magnetic field is taken as B. The induced magnetic field of a substance is taken as B. And the applied magnetic field is taken as H. It is the applied magnetic field. And B is the induced magnetic field. Suppose if B is going to be lesser than H, that means this substance is not going to be attracted towards this applied magnetic field. Actually, the substance is going to get repelled. The substance is going to get repelled by the applied magnetic field. Then such substances are called as diamagnetic substances. Once again, if any substance is going to get repelled by applied magnetic field, that substances are called as diamagnetic substances. Why they are going to get repelled? Because of presence of
completely filled.
You have to say because of presence of paired electrons. Paired electrons means this is a pair, this is a pair, this is a pair. Suppose I am saying they are the lone pairs. Suppose I am going to use the word lone pairs. If so many number of lone pairs are there, between them repulsion arises. So that's why if any ion or a complex is having completely filled subshell or paired electrons, there is no unpaired electrons, then the induced magnetic field is going to be opposed by applied magnetic field. Simply I can say in chemistry terms, the any substance, if any substance which is going to opposed by, which is going to be repelled by applied magnetic field, that substances are called as diamagnetic substances. What are paramagnetic substances? What are paramagnetic substances means which if any substance is there, which is attracted partially, only partially attraction, not the strong attraction, partial attraction towards applied magnetic field. If any substance get attracted partially towards applied magnetic substance or applied magnetic field, then that is called as paramagnetic substance. If any substance is strongly attracted towards applied magnetic field, then that is called as ferromagnetic substance. Paramagnetic substances are going to have unpaired electrons. Ferromagnetic substances are going to have unpaired electrons, but not diamagnetic substances. So on the screen, you are seeing all the data. Please take the screenshot. Whatever I underlined, read that, you can understand better. But one thing is, here you have to remember the examples. Ti4 plus, V5 plus, Zn, Hg, Cd. Can you tell me whether they are contain any unpaired electrons? Ti4 plus. Okay, I'm writing titanium or titanium. Atomic number is?
22.
The electronic configuration is argon 4s2 3d2. How many unpaired electrons are present here? 2 unpaired electrons. So if titanium is going to lose all the 4 electrons, then 4s becomes 0, 3d becomes 0. So Ti4 plus is having no unpaired electrons. If there is no unpaired electrons, then it becomes diamagnetic. So Ti4 plus, like that, V5 plus, SC3 plus, Zn, Hg, Cd. What are these? Which group elements these are? Zinc, cadmium, and mercury belongs to second B group. Write down that point. Zinc, cadmium, and mercury belongs to second B group. They are diamagnetic substances. They are diamagnetic substances. And mercury. Mercury is taken in the mercury ion form. That is Hg2 2+. Hg2 2+, that is also diamagnetic in nature. So if any space is said to be as diamagnetic, you can understand that there is no presence of unpaired electrons. There is no presence of unpaired electrons. Take the screenshot of this one regarding diamagnetic substances and ferromagnetic substances. Ferromagnetic substances contain large number of unpaired electrons, and all those are aligned in same orientation. Means, if some 4 unpaired electrons are there, the 4 unpaired electrons are going to have S value same, plus off, plus off, plus off, plus off. So if same spin is there for more number of unpaired electrons, that substances are called as ferromagnetic substances. If same spin is there, but less number of unpaired electrons are there, that is called as paramagnetic substances. So ferromagnetism is a special category of paramagnetic substances or paramagnetism. In the case of ferromagnetic substances, the condition is the induced magnetic field is more than applied magnetic field. B is greater than H. Whereas in the paramagnetic substances, for paramagnetic substances, what should be the formula? B is lesser, B is greater than H. Yes, very good. B is greater than H is indicating the condition is paramagnetic substance. B is greater than H is indicating ferromagnetic substance. And B is lesser than H is indicating. B is lesser than H is indicating diamagnetic substance. These three concepts are important, ma. And already we know how to calculate the magnetic moment. What is the formula we used in complex compounds to calculate the magnetic moment? Mu is equal to
square root of
n into n plus 2. N plus 1 or 2?
2.
Square root of n into n plus 1 or 2, ma? 1 or 2? Who is talking on the line unnecessarily? If you don't want the class, just leave the class. Every day we have to say like this. Some boy student is, I'm hearing here. I'm seriously saying the class, teaching the class. Why are you interrupting my class? Okay, sorry. So once again, ma. In complex compound chapter or coordination compound chapter, we studied the magnetic moment, mu. Mu is called as magnetic moment. So magnetic moment mu is equal to square root of n into n plus 2. Are you sure? Is there any doubt? Okay, fine. Remember this formula. Don't get confused. Just by heart. More by hearting is required. Mu is equal to square root of n into n plus 2 Bohr magnetons. H Here the formula, one Bohr magneton. It is the physics terminology actually. In physics, you know all these formulas. In the chapter, I think units and dimensions. One magneton is equal to, write down this formula. One magneton, Bohr magneton. One Bohr magneton. The scientist Bohr is calculated the magnetic moment. It is called as Bohr magneton. One Bohr magneton is equal to EH by 4 pi mc. EH by 4 pi mc. E is equal to charge of electron. H is the Planck's constant. M is the mass of electron. C is nothing but velocity of light or speed of light. One Bohr magneton. Remember this value, ma. Direct question it is. You have to add the value. One Bohr magneton is equal to 9.273 into 10 to the power of minus 24 joules per Tesla. This unit is important. Joules per Tesla, or that is equal to 9.273 into 10 to the power of minus 21 X per gauss. So all these are the units generally we use in physics, not regularly in chemistry. Anyhow, coming to the 3D series elements, we are discussing about only 3D series elements. So in the case of 3D series elements, the magnetic moment is not only due to spinning of electrons. S is indicating spin quantum number. L indicates azimuthal quantum number. Azimuthal quantum number also called as orbital angular quantum number. So the magnetic moment of 3D series elements and their ions and their complexes, not only due to spinning of electrons, but also due to the spinning of orbitals. So then to calculate magnetic moment for 3D series elements, we are using the not for the 3D series, except of 3D series, that is 4D series, 5D series, and for 6D series elements. Once again, it is the formula used for calculation of magnetic moment for complexes formed by 4D series, 5D series, and 6D series. Write down this formula. The magnetic moment of 4D, 5D, 6D series elements and their complexes. Once again, the magnetic moment of 4D, 5D, 6D series elements and their complexes can be calculated by using the formula mu S plus L is equal to square root of 4S into S plus 1 plus L into L plus 1 Bohr magnetons, where S indicates sum of the spin quantum numbers. Sum of the spin quantum numbers. Suppose 4 unpaired electrons are there. What is the spin sum of the spin quantum number?
Plus 2 or minus 2.
Plus 2 or minus 2. Correct. Because every electron is having either plus of spin quantum number or minus of spin quantum number. But one thing you have to understand, when we are saying paramagnetic, all the electrons are aligned in one pattern, in one dimension or in one direction. So if you take plus of, for remaining all the electrons, you have to take plus of. Otherwise, if you are taking minus off, for all the remaining electrons, you have to take minus off. But in general, what we have to take? Plus off. Because we are getting the positive values. Suppose if any complex is given, minus 0.75 Bohr magneton. Is it exist? Is that value exist? No. So that's why, in general, we are taking the spin quantum number as plus off. But of course, for every electron, we are knowing that spin quantum numbers may be plus off or minus off. So to calculate the total sum of the spin quantum number, capital S is equal to spin quantum number of electron, small s. Small s is indicating spin quantum number of electron, that is plus of, into number of unpaired electrons. Capital S is equal to small s into small n. Capital S is indicating sum of the spin quantum numbers, that can be calculated by multiplying number of unpaired electrons with the spin quantum number, where n value is indicating number of unpaired electrons. Bohr magneton is equal to eh by 4 pi mc, whereas one Bohr magneton is equal to 9.273 × 10⁻²⁴ joules tesla, or 9.273 × 10⁻²⁶ eggs per gas. So coming to some of the complex ions or transition metal ions, not the complex ions, transition metal ions. Scandium 3+, the configuration is 3d0. 3d0 is indicating there is no unpaired electrons. So that's why the magnetic moment of Sc3+ is equal to 0. This is important bit, note down. The magnetic moment of Sc3+ is 0 bm, 0 Bohr magneton. Remaining all the things, you can take the screenshot, you can by hand, or you can calculate. What is the formula we have to use here to calculate the magnetic moment? What is the formula we have to use? Mu is equal to
root over n root of square root of
n into small n into n plus 2. Remember this one. After that, you can calculate. But one thing, observe here. Calculated values are different from observed values. Suppose if you calculate the magnetic moment for titanium 3+, you are going to get the value as 1.73. But experimentally, it is observed as 1.7 to 1.8. So there is a variation between calculated magnetic moment versus observed magnetic moment. So magnetic moments are not completely theoretical. The magnetic moments are experimental, but nearest values we can calculate by using this formula. Mu is equal to square root of n into n plus 2. All of you take the screenshot. From this one, if the question will be asked, it is very easy. No need of remembering observed values. Just you can write the calculated value. So one more is here, zinc 2+. Zinc 2+ is also having no unpaired electrons. Hence, the magnetic moment is equal to 0. So what are diamagnetic ions in this table? What are the diamagnetic ions? Yes, write down that one. Sc3+, Zn2+ are diamagnetic in nature. Yes, one more screenshot. Whatever I underlined, whatever I ticked, try to practice them. All of you take the screenshot first. If you are missing the screenshots, I'm uploading the videos. You can skip the video to any particular point. There you can take the screenshot again. So there is no question of missing my topic. You can again listen, but little bit boring, I think. But if anybody wants, there is an option to listen again. Next topic, colors of transition metal ions. Just now we discussed, because of presence of unpaired electrons in either n-1d orbitals or in nd orbitals, dd transition will take place in the presence of visible light. Particularly here, visible light is required. So in the presence of visible light only, the unpaired n-1d electrons or nd electrons are undergoing a dd transition. And the color what we are seeing, that is due to complementary color, not due to absorbed color. Whatever the color we are seeing, that is the complementary color, but not the absorbed color. Here, two examples are given. One is hydrated titanium ion. Hydrated titanium ion is having one 3D electron that is going to absorb green color lights from the visible region, and that is going to transmit purple light or pink colored light. Everything you have to by head here. The colors you have to by head. And second one, hydrated copper ions. All of you know the color of hydrated copper ion, deep blue color. Deep blue color. Hydrated copper ions are deep blue color, but they are going to absorb red color radiation. And manganese 2 ions in aqueous medium, they are going to transmit pink color. Take the screenshot of this one. Next, one more screenshot. Colors of visible radiations. First heading, absorbed color and wavelength of color and complementary color. If any complex ion is going to absorb violet color radiation, that appears as yellowish green color complex. If any complex is going to absorb blue color radiation, that appears as yellow color complex. If any complex absorbs greenish blue color radiation, then it appears as orange color radiation. Like that, remaining all the colors are given here. Just listen one thing. When you are wearing any one particular color dress, any one particular color dress, not white color, not black color. I'm not saying about white color and black color. Other than white and black color, if any other colored dresses when you are wear, when you go to spotlight, for any particular light, if it is going to fall on your dress color will change. Of course, the color remains the same, but we will see a different color. So if a different color is going to be focused on your dress, again, we will see a different color. So whatever the colors the dress is going to absorb, we are going to see at different colors. So the colors we are seeing are called as complementary colors. So all it is due to, the complementary colors is due to whatever the colors we are going to see, not the colors going to be absorbed by the substance. That is the thing you have to understand here. So try to behead the absorbed colors versus complementary colors. No need of remembering wavelengths. Don't try to remember the wavelengths. And tell me, WIBZR, all of you know about WIBZR. WIBZR, violet, indigo, blue, green, yellow, orange, and red. In this one, just I'm going to focus on violet as well as on the red. Tell me about wavelengths. Which one is having highest wavelength?
Red
color radiation is having highest wavelength. In the sunset, if you observe the sunset or sunrise, we can see the sun very clearly, but not in the mid of the day. In the mid of the day, we can't see the sun easily. But at the sunset or sunrise, we can see the sun very easily because that wavelength is having longest wavelength. Longest wavelength means red color radiation is having longest wavelength in visible radiation. This is important both for physics and chemistry. Longest wavelength radiation is red color radiation. Longest wavelength means, what is meant by longest wavelength? Up to maximum distance it can travel. Is it clear? Is it correct?
Yes, sir.
Yes. So up to the maximum distance. That's why for the bikes or for the cars, for the vehicles, what we use for the brake light? Red light.
Red light.
If you press the brake on the back of your scooty or bike, you can observe red color light. Because for the maximum distance, the red color light is visible than the remaining lights. So that's why the red color is used for the danger signals. Because the red color light can travel to the maximum distance because of its longest wavelength. When the wavelength is maximum, what about the frequency?
Less.
When the frequency is less, what about the energy?
Less.
Yes. There is a relation between wavelength and frequency. Lambda is equal to, or lambda is inversely proportional to, lambda is inversely proportional to nu. What is meant by nu?
Frequency.
Otherwise, we can also write lambda is equal to, can you say the formula? Lambda is equal to?
Hc by E.
E is equal to?
energy.
E is equal to hc by lambda. Energy is equal to energy of electromagnetic radiations. E is equal to hc by lambda. Or we can also write 1 by lambda. 1 by lambda is equal to nu bar. All of you know wave number, nu bar. So energy is equal to hc nu bar. Everything hc nu bar. So these are the formulas we are using in both physics as well as in chemistry. Coming to this absorbed colors as well as complementary colors. The complementary color, which complementary color can be visible up to the maximum distance? Which complementary color can be visible up to the maximum distance?
Red.
Try to listen the question first, try to understand then. Which complementary color can be observed up to the maximum distance?
Blue green.
When we are going to see the red color? When we are going to see the red color, ma?
Blue green color.
Observed. When blue green color is absorbed by the substance, then we are going to see the red color radiation. So by practicing the MCQs, you can understand the concept. So try to practice. Of course, I think so. Based on this, no MCQs are given. If there are any MCQs, by practicing that, you can understand better. Anyhow, is there any doubt in this concept?
No, sir.
Okay. Yes, all these are about colors only. Take the screenshot of this one. DD transition. DD transition. Generally, most of the complexes are octahedral. You know, octahedral complexes, square planar complexes, tetrahedral complexes. But most of the complexes are octahedral complexes. If I am saying that statement, most of the complexes are octahedral, what do you think about energy levels of the d orbitals?
T2g orbitals are less energetic than eg orbitals.
Very good, super. T2g orbitals are lesser energetic than eg orbitals. So if I am saying like that, how can you understand the dd transition? How can you understand the dd transition? Very simple. Sir, I am taking some complex that is having some number of unpaired electrons in lower energy level T2g orbitals. By absorbing the sunlight, the electrons, unpaired electrons at the T2g orbitals are jumping into Eg orbitals. But again, they are coming back by emitting the energy. That emitted energy is having complementary colored frequency radiation. Then only we are seeing different colors. So please take the screenshot and right side of the screen. Right side of the screen, for all the ions, different colors are given. And among them, it is difficult to remember all the colors, but it is very easy to remember the colorless species. At least try to remember the colorless species. Sc3 plus is colorless because it is having no unpaired electrons. And Cu plus, this is important. Cu plus is having 3d10 configuration, it is colorless. Cu2 plus is colored. Cu plus is colorless. Cu2 plus is colored. Cu2 plus in aqueous medium is a bluish colored complex. If it is possible to you, try to behead the colors. Otherwise, just skip the concept. Only thing you have to remember is presence of unpaired electrons, and due to dd transition in the presence of visible light, the absorbed radiation is not going to be visible. Only the transmitted radiation, that is called as complementary radiation, is visible. That is the main concept you have to understand here. Yes, I'm taking two more compounds of 3D series. Very important compounds of 3D series. And within 5 minutes, we are going to study those two compounds. First compound is KMnO4, potassium permanganate. KMnO4 is called as potassium permanganate. What is the oxidation state of manganese here?
+7.
What is the configuration of T2G and Eg? What is the 3D configuration?
Zero.
Very good. So in KMnO4, 3D orbitals are having no unpaired electrons. No unpaired electrons means T2Z0, Ez is zero. Is there any DD transition is possible? In this,
no.
Yes. Here, there is no possibility of DD transition because there is no unpaired electrons are present in. There is no unpaired electrons are present in 3D orbitals. So that's why there is no DD transition is possible. Even though there is no DD transition, this compound, potassium permanganate, is a colored compound. It is a colored compound. How this color is going to be obtained? Very simple. When it is going to ionize to give K plus ions and MnO4 minus ions. MnO4 minus ion is called as permanganate ion. MnO4 minus ion is called as permanganate ion. In permanganate ion, manganese is present in plus 7 oxidation state with 3D zero configuration. From this oxygen, electrons are going to come into 3D orbitals of manganese, again going to get a D exit. So this phenomena is called as charge transfer. Charge transfer. Important keyword, ma. Charge transfer phenomena. So the charge transfer phenomena is observed in KMnO4. That's why even though there is no DD transition in KMnO4, still KMnO4 is colored. Important point. In MCQs also, you can find KMnO4 is colored due to charge transfer phenomena. And one more example, K2CR2O7. K2CR2O7, potassium dichromate. In potassium dichromate, the oxidation state of chromium is plus 6. K2CR2O7, the compound is called as potassium dichromate. Yes, here the configuration is again same, 3D zero. Here also the same phenomena is happening, charge transfer phenomena. So that is the specialty of chemistry, everywhere exception, exception, exception. So here the exception is because of charge transfer phenomena. K2CR2O7 is also a colored compound. Take the screenshot of these two. Here I start the point. The chromium in plus 6 oxidation state, manganese is in plus 7 oxidation state, have empty d orbitals, but their compounds are colored. Because if their oxo ions are taken, oxo anions are taken, dichromate ion, CR2O7 2- is called as dichromate ion, CrO4 2- is called as chromate ion, MnO4- is called as permanganate ion. All these are going to exhibit the phenomena, charge transfer phenomena. That's why all these ions and their compounds are colored compounds. Next topic, side reading. Catalytic property of transition metals. Catalytic property of transition metals. Yes, what is the characteristic properties of 3D series elements? Or what are the characteristic properties of transition elements?
To exhibit multiple oxidation states.
Variable oxidation states. Is there any other characteristic properties? D-block elements, transition elements are having transition elements are having different characteristic properties. One is variable oxidation states. Second one is they act as good catalysts. The third one is they can form complex compounds. The fourth one is they can form colored ions in aqueous solutions. And the fourth one is they can form alloys. There are so many characteristic properties are there. So among them, one of the characteristic properties is catalytic property. So why these elements are going to act as catalysts? First of all, we have to know what is meant by catalyst. Can you tell me the definition of catalysts? What is meant by catalysts?
Increase the rate of reaction.
of course increase the rate of reaction, okay,
without involving material.
That is important. Increase the rate of reaction, increase any chemical substance which increases the rate of reaction without change in its chemical composition. That is important. Without change in its chemical composition. Without change in the chemical composition, then only the substance is called as a catalyst. Of course, in any chemical reaction, the catalyst initially going to change. Initially, the composition of catalyst is going to change during the reaction, but after the reaction, the catalyst is going to get, after the reaction, the catalyst is going to get regenerate. So initially, the catalyst is going to get react, but after the completion of reaction, the catalyst is going to get regenerate. Then only they are called as catalysts. So now coming to the examples, on the screen you are seeing iron 3, that is Fe3 plus ions. Iron 3 ions catalyze the reaction between iodide and per-disulfate ion. Iodide, I minus ions are called as iodide ions. S2O8 minus ions are called as per-disulfate ions. So when iodide ions are reacting with per-disulfate ions, that gives iodine and sulfate ions. SO4 minus is called as sulfate ions. Per-disulfate ions are converting into sulfate ions. Now tell me, in this reaction, per-disulfate ions are converting into sulfate ions. What is the reaction, half reaction? Whether it is oxidation or reduction? The conversion of per-disulfate ions to sulfate ions, whether the reaction is oxidation reaction or reduction reaction? Per-disulfate ions to sulfate ions, what is the type of reaction?
Reductions.
Okay, to avoid the confusion, to make easy, I'm taking this reaction. I minus to I2. Very easy. I minus is indicating iodine is present in minus one oxidation state. I2 is indicating iodine is present in zero oxidation state. Minus one to zero is indicating oxidation half reaction. If any space is involving in oxidation half reaction, that act as a reducing agent. Iodide ions are acting as reducing agents. Iodide ions are acting as reducing agents, right? So then S2O8 minus ions, that is per-disulfate ions, are converting into sulfate ions. Here, what is this reaction? What is this reaction? Reduction half reaction, right? Is it clear? S2O8 minus ions to SO4 minus ions, the reaction is reduction half reaction. If it is a reduction half reaction, what is the nature of S2O8 minus?
Oxidizing agent.
That is important. Per disulfate ions reacting with iodide ions act as oxidizing agent. Per disulfate ion reacting with I minus ions or iodide ions act as oxidizing agent. So this is a reaction. Actually, we are seeing this reaction is happening in a single step. This reaction is happening in a single step. But the reactions, most of the reactions, not completes in a single step. They are complex. They carry in multiple steps. So first of all, the iodide ion of the reaction reacting with ferric ion. Then the ferric ions are converting into ferrous ions. Iodide ion is oxidized to iodine. Here, what is happening? Iodide ion is oxidized to iodine. So that is the first step. Oxidation of iodide to iodine. In this reaction, Fe3 plus is involving and the chemical composition is changed from Fe3 plus to Fe2 plus. But in the second reaction, the formed Fe2 plus ions are reacting with per-disulfate ions. Then per-disulfate ions are converting into sulfate ions. During this process, again, there is a regeneration of Fe3 plus ions. So initially, we are taking Fe3 plus ions. They are converting into Fe2 plus ions. Again, they are converting into Fe3 plus ions. Means there is no change in the chemical composition of Fe3 plus. So here we can say that Fe3 plus is acting as a catalyst. So now, once again, we can define what is meant by catalyst means. any chemical substance or any chemical species which involves in the reaction to increase the speed of reaction without any change in its chemical composition. So here we are discussing about iron. Iron in plus 3 oxidation state is acting as catalyst. Iron is an example of transition element. So the transition elements and their ions, they are acting as good catalyst because of what is the reason? Because of variable oxidation states. The catalytic activity of transition elements is because of variable oxidation states. Here in this reaction, iron is converting into, first Fe3 plus is converting into Fe2 plus. Again, Fe2 plus is converting into Fe3 plus. So iron is having variable, iron can exhibit variable oxidation states. So if any element can exhibit variable oxidation state, that elements can be used as catalyst. So all the transition elements are capable to exhibit variable oxidation states. That's why the transition metals and their ions, they are used as catalyst, except of scandium. Exception is there for scandium. Scandium can exhibit oxidation state of plus 3 only. So even though scandium is a transition element, but it is not used as a catalyst in general. It is not used as a catalyst because it is not going to exhibit a variable oxidation states. Scandium is the only transition element that is not going to exhibit variable oxidation state. Hence, scandium is not used as catalyst. Write down that point. In transition elements, in 3D series, I'm saying about 3D series. In 3D series elements, scandium is the only element unable to exhibit variable oxidation states. Hence, it is not used as a catalyst. Of course, you will get a doubt. Sir, in 3D series elements, zinc is also there, sir. At the end of the series, in the second B group, zinc is also there. Of course, it is not a transition element, non-transition element. We are discussing only about transition elements because the transition elements are acting as catalysts when they are going to exhibit variable oxidation states. All of you take the screenshot of this one. All the underlined one are very important for NEET examination. Particularly, this screen is very important. This screenshot is very important for the NEET examination. First one, about Ziegler-Natta catalyst. In the first year also, you heard about this word, Ziegler-Natta catalyst. A mixture of titanium or titanium tetrachloride with aluminium. Trialkyl aluminum. This is 3. 3 is called as tri. This group is called as alkyl group. This is called as aluminum. Trialkyl aluminum. Once again, write down. Ziegler-Natta catalyst is a mixture of Ziegler. Here spelling is there on the screen. Ziegler-Natta catalyst is a mixture of titanium tetrachloride mixed with trialkyl aluminum. And it is used in the manufacturing of polythene. Very important, ma. Ziegler-Natta catalyst. Next one. In Wacker's process, this is also important. Wacker's process, the oxidation of ethyne to ethanol is catalyzed by palladium chloride. Wacker's process. Remember the name? Wacker's process. In Wacker's process, ethyne is converting into ethanol. What is meant by the formula of ethyne? What is the formula of ethane?
Triple bond.
CH.
Triple bond.
Triple bond. CH is the formula of ethane. So here ethane is converting into ethanol. What is the formula of ethanol?
CH3CH2OH.
Ethanol. CH3 yes. Single bond, CH2. C double bond O, single bond H. Two carbons are there. Ether. Between carbon and carbon, single bond is there. N. C double bond O H is called as all. Conversion of ethane to ethanol. The process is Wacker's process. Write down this reaction. Wacker's process. Catalyst used is, the catalyst used is palladium chloride, PdCl2. Next, you know about the contact process. Already you know very well. Contact process. What is the catalyst used in contact process? Vanadium pentoxide. What is the use of contact process? In contact process, what we are going to prepare? What we are going to manufacture
sulfuric
in contact?
Sulfuric acid.
Yes.
Uric acid.
Yes. Pardon? For the manufacturing of sulfuric acid by contact process, the catalyst used is V2O5. The catalyst used is V2O5. Next one. In the manufacture of ammonia by Haber's process, we use a mixture of iron and molybdenum as the catalyst. Next, in the manufacture of nitric acid, remember the formula HNO3. In the manufacture of nitric acid by Ostwald process, we use platinum as the catalyst. Next one. The catalyst used in hydrogenation of oils is nickel. Last one, Fenton's reagent. Very important. Very important for NEET examination. Fenton's reagent is FeSO4, that is ferrous sulfate, mixed with hydrogen peroxide. H2O2 is called as hydrogen peroxide. Ferrous sulfate mixed with hydrogen peroxide. This mixture is called as Fenton's reagent. It is used as oxidizing agent. Next topic, slide reading. Interstitial compounds. Of course, in the solid state, already you know this topic, interstitial compounds. Please open your mic. Talk to me. What is meant by interstitial space? What is meant by interstitial space? Okay, wait a minute. I'm going to draw something here. Tell me now. After drawing, you can tell me. I'm taking an atom. All of you know atoms are spherical in shape. And again, an atom. Try to consider they're joined with each other. It's not easy to write circularly on the screen. So they are joined with each other. Now, can you spot what is the interstitial space? Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 atoms I have taken. Where the interstitial space is present?
Between 1, 2, 5, 6.
Very good. Between 1, 2, 5, 6, this space is called as interstitial space. So, with compared to size of the atom, what about the size of interstitial space?
Less.
Very small. Actually, I'm showing a little bit large. With compared to size of the atoms, the interstitial space is very small. What are having small size in the atoms? Small-sized atoms. Small-sized atoms are first period elements as well as second period elements. They are having very small size. Of course, first period elements are having very small size. And in a period, from left to right, atomic size decreases. Suppose if I am going to take the second period elements. Second period elements are lithium, beryllium, boron, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, fluorine, but not neon. Because neon is not reactive. So, which elements can involve in the formation of interstitial compounds? Which elements can involve in the formation of interstitial compounds? All these elements, of course, fluorine also. But we are going to study some of the examples. Boron, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, fluorine, hydrogen. All these are being very small in size. These are going to captured. All these elements are going to be captured into the interstitial space of the transition elements. Then the formed compounds are called as interstitial compounds. Suppose if hydrogen is going to be trapped into the interstitial space, that is called as interstitial hydrides. If carbon is going to be trapped, that is called as interstitial carbides. If oxygen is going to be trapped, interstitial oxides. If nitrogen is trapped, interstitial nitrides. So here we are seeing about interstitial compounds formed by transition elements. On the screen, interstitial compounds, they can be formed by transition elements when between the gaps of the transition metal atoms, small size atoms like hydrogen, boron, carbon, nitrogen are trapped in the holes of the transition metals, then the compounds are called as interstitial compounds. And they are also called as non-stoichiometric compounds. This is important. The interstitial compounds are also called as non-stoichiometric compounds because there is no particular ratio of binding of atoms. See the examples here. Fe 0.82O, Fe 0.940, WO 2.88, WO 2.92. So all these are not having any particular ratio. So this type of compounds are called as interstitial compounds. Okay, coming to the properties of interstitial compounds, they're having high melting point, boiling points, they're having a high metallic nature, they're hard and brittle in nature, and their densities. Coming to the densities, whether the density get increased or decreased with compared to transition metal. Suppose see this one. Only iron is taken. I'm going to take the iron metal. A piece of iron metal contains so many number of iron atoms. In that iron atoms, between the iron atoms, in the interstitial space, when the oxygen atoms are going to be trapped, whether the density of that metal or the density of an interstitial compound increases or decreases. Okay, see this point. The density of these compounds is less than that of the metals. This is important. The density of interstitial compounds is less than that of the metals due to expansion of the lattice. Write down this point. The density of these compounds or the density of interstitial compounds. The density of interstitial compounds is less than that of the metals due to expansion of lattice. Titanium, zirconium, hafnium, vanadium, niobium, tantalum, iron, tungsten, all the transition elements, not only all these. All the transition elements, they are capable to form interstitial compounds. And this is a major important point. Hydrogen occupies tetrahedral holes. Hydrogen always occupies tetrahedral holes, while carbon and nitrogen occupies octahedral holes. In the solid state, you studied already what is a tetrahedral void, what is an octahedral void, how they are going to be formed, And what is the relation between tetrahedral voids and octahedral voids? On the right side of the screen, you are seeing the formation of tetrahedral voids and octahedral voids. I am not going in detail because it is not the solid state. My question to you is, why hydrogen is going to occupy only tetrahedral voids? Why the carbon and nitrogen is going to occupy octahedral voids? What is the reason? One more question to you. Among the tetrahedral voids, this is the tetrahedral void, and this is the octahedral void here. Which size is large? The size of tetrahedral void and octahedral void, which one is larger in size?
Octahedral void.
Correct. Write down. Among the tetrahedral voids and octahedral voids, the size of octahedral voids is larger than the size of tetrahedral voids. Once again, the size of octahedral voids is larger than the size of tetrahedral voids. Okay, tell me, among hydrogen, carbon and nitrogen, which one is having small size?
Hydrogen.
So that's why the hydrogen is going to occupy tetrahedral voids, whereas carbon and nitrogen, they are going to occupy octahedral voids. So large size atoms are going to occupy octahedral voids. Small size atoms are going to occupy tetrahedral voids. That is the reason. This point is important, ma. For assertion and reasoning type of questions, the point is important. Yes, sir. Here, one more point. Zinc oxide. When zinc oxide is observed, the zinc oxide generally appears as white in color. In cold condition, that means without any heating, the zinc oxide appears as white in color. But when the same zinc oxide is going to be heated, that hot zinc oxide is going to appear as yellowish color. White is means the stoichiometric compound is changing to non-stoichiometric compound. When the zinc oxide is going to be heated strongly, zinc oxide remains. But the stoichiometric compound is converting into non-stoichiometric compound. The non-stoichiometric compound that is going to have different number of unpaired electrons, different arrangement of atoms. That's why the zinc oxide in hot condition is going to exhibit the color, yellowish color. Whereas in cold condition, zinc oxide is having no color. So based on stoichiometry also, we can say about the colors of the complexes, colors of the metal ions. Next slide reading. Alloy formation. What is meant by alloy? Alloy is a homogeneous mixture of metal with other metals or metalloids or non-metals. Alloys are solid in solid solutions. All of you please respond. How many types of solutions are there?
9 types.
Correct, 9 types. So among them, one of the solution is solid in solid type of solution. Remember this one. Alloys are the examples of solid in solid type of solutions. Why they are going to form alloys? What is the use of formation of alloys? What is the use of formation of alloys? Suppose I am going to take iron. I'm going to construct my home by using iron metal. Can I construct my home with by using iron metal? Can I construct my home or my house by using iron metal? Is it good?
No, sir.
Why?
Iron undergoes rust.
Very good. Iron undergoes rusting. So we should not use metals directly. In the industry, we should not use metals directly because metals are having rusting nature or corrosion property. The metals are having corrosion property. So that's why metals never directly used in any industry. Even if you use the gold ring, in the gold ring, is there pure gold is present?
No, sir.
What is there present in gold ring?
Copper.
Yes, gold. Gold that is Au mixed with Cu. Why we are going to add copper? What is the use of addition of copper? To lower the price, sir. Right? What is the use of addition of copper?
No, sir.
Why we are
gold adding? Gold is unable to melt.
Unable to? Pure gold is a soft metal.
To strengthen.
To strengthen. So to strengthen the metals. To make the metals suitable to industries, we have to make the alloys. So that is the main concept here. See this one. Alloys are generally prepared to modify the properties like malleability, ductility, toughness, resistance to corrosion. So because of this reason only, we are preparing the alloys. We are manufacturing the alloys. And alloy is a homogeneous mixer of, this is most important. Alloy is a homogeneous mixer of metal with other metals or metalloids or non-metals, and alloy is a solid in solid solution. And okay, before going to the topic, alloys. There are two types of alloys, Ma. Do you know what are the two types of alloys? What are the two types of alloys? Do you know the two types of alloys? One is ferrous alloys. Second one is non-ferrous alloys. In the statement itself, it is there. If any alloy is having iron, that is called as ferro alloy. This is the non-ferro alloy. Non-ferro alloy means that is not going to have the iron. I'm going to give you some examples regarding ferro alloys and non-ferro alloys. In your material, at the end of the chapter, you can find the alloys, ferro alloys and non-ferro alloys. On the screen, you are seeing. Take the screenshot of this one, otherwise follow your material. But you have to behead all these things. Some examples for ferrous alloys and some examples for non-ferrous alloys. Examples for both ferro alloys and non-ferro alloys, or ferrous alloys and non-ferrous alloys. Among this, the main important are, what are the important you have to remember? For your intermediate level or PU level, you heard about brass. What is meant by brass? What is the composition of brass? 60 to 80% of copper mixed with 20 to 40% of zinc is called as brass. Brass is used in machinery parts. Next one important, bronze. It is a composition of 75 to 90% copper mixed with 10 to 25% tin. Sn is called as tin. So bronze is used in making of utensils, coins, as well as statues. Try to use your two fingers on the screen. Enlarge the screen. The font size is very small. Please enlarge the screen. Where I am making the pen mark, please enlarge there. So once again, utensils. In our house, in our home, we are using so many utensils in the kitchen. So all those utensils are made up of bronze, It is containing 75 to 90% of copper, 10 to 25% of tin. Of course, 75 to 90% of copper. Whether we are using copper utensils in our home?
No, sir.
Which utensils we are using? Which utensils we are using in our home? Do you know? Steel, correct. Steel utensils, correct answer. Steel utensils we are using in general. Steel, of course, steel also contains iron. So steel is also an example of ferroalloy. Okay, coming to the second next one, gunmetal. This is also important, ma. Gunmetal composition: 88% copper, 10% tin, 2% zinc. Gunmetal. Gunmetal is used in manufacturing of guns as well as bearings. Do you know about bearings? What is the use of bearing? If you observe the fan, if you observe any mortar, to run the mortar smoothly, the part used is called as bearings. So bearings are made up of gunmetal. Remember this one. Bearings are made up of gunmetal. So every engine contains bearing. Without bearing, there is no engine. So all the engines are made up of bearings that contains gunmetal. And coming to the bell metal, we are using bell rings. So the bell metal contains 80% of copper, 20% of tin. So just I am underlining the important one. And on the left side, Invar steel as well as nichrome or nichrome. Invar steel contains 64% iron, 35% nickel. It is used for the pendulum rods. All of you know pendulum. In the physics, regularly you go through pendulums. So to make the pendulums of clock, we use Invar steel. It contains traces of manganese and carbon. Next, nichrome or nichrome. 60% of nickel mixed with 25% of iron, 15% of chromium. It is used in heating of fire stoves and furnaces. Very, 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 very important. Furnaces. Where we are using, where we are observed the furnaces? In which topic we observed the furnaces, ma?
Metallurgy.
Yes, metallurgy. So, with the help of the furnaces, we are going to extract the metals. Extraction, extract the metals. So, for the extraction of metals, first of all, the ore should be converted into purest form. That is concentration of ore. After concentration of ore, the concentrated ore should be converted into its oxide. Then oxide should be converted into reduced form. The oxide should be converted into reduced form. That is the not final form, last before. The reduced form of metal is finally converted into purest form. Purest form. So there are different steps in the extraction of metal. In the last step, the reduced form of metals are taken into the furnaces to get purest form of the metals. So that furnaces are constructed with the help of nichrome or nichrome. Let's take the screenshot of this one. In the next class, of course, I tried to complete the topic today itself, but it becomes a little bit lengthy. Can I continue the session? Already 1 hour 50 minutes is there, completed. Okay, tomorrow we'll discuss about potassium permanganate and potassium dichromate. K2CR2O7 is called as potassium dichromate. KMnO4 is called as potassium permanganate. Just give me a minute. So all these topics we have to discuss. First one is about the potassium dichromate preparation, physical properties and chemical reactions uses, and then potassium dichromate. It will take up to 40 minutes or 50 minutes. So today I will continue. Sorry, not today. Tomorrow I will continue.